God bless you, loved ones. Welcome to the Word with Chester. Today we'll begin studying the 29th chapter of the book of Exodus. I am genuinely humbled each time I stand before you. I count it a blessing to be able to share God's Word with you. For more than 30 years of my life, I've given all that I possibly can to the upbuilding of the kingdom of God and to sharing the good news with as many people as I possibly can. I'm committed to do so, and I do know that God spoke to me and told me to start this ministry really very close to 3 years ago. If you want to know the truth, we have an anniversary that will be coming the first week in April. God has blessed us to be on the air and broadcasting this ministry for 3 years now. And I am so happy to know all of you, or those of you that have let me know that you're watching. It's a blessing to me just to know that you are. I have given my life and will continue to give my life to the upbuilding of the kingdom of God. Well, shall we read in verse 1 of chapter 29? This is somewhat of a long chapter, so we will not be able to go completely through the chapter, but I'm going to do a lot of reading. Again, God is giving instructions. Prior to this, he gave instructions to the construction or the making of the garments of the priest, who Aaron and his sons would wear. And here we're going into where God is getting ready to consecrate them as priests. And that's one thing about God. He consecrates people to do a certain job. There's a lot of people that do jobs, but they have not been consecrated by God to do them. And I'm like this, regardless to what's happening, I want God's anointing to be with me, and I want him to consecrate me into whatever office that I uphold. Right now, this small ministry, I know he told me to do it, so he consecrated me to do it. And the next move, that elevation that he gives us, I want him to consecrate me to do that. I am not into just having positions to have positions. I want to do a work for the Lord, and I want his presence and his spirit to be with me. Well, here he's getting ready to instruct Moses on how to consecrate the priest. Let's read in verse 1 of chapter 29. And this is the thing that thou shalt do unto them, to hallow them, or get them in the mode in where they need to be. Hallow them, get them into a place where people will respect them and honor what they do. Shall I read? And this is the thing that thou shalt do unto them, to hallow them, to minister unto the priest office. Take one young bullock and two rams without blemish, and unleavened bread, and cakes unleavened, tempered with oil, and wafer unleavened, anointed with oil of wheaten flour, shalt thou make them. Well, he's giving instructions on how to consecrate them, what to do when you do consecrate them. Now, let's continue reading in verse 3. Let me just read on, if you would, today. Remember, our motive is to read completely through the Bible, verse by verse and chapter by chapter. And I will give commentary as needed, but our focus is reading completely through the Bible. I don't want to skip one verse. I don't want to skip one word. I want it all to be read so that you will hear and you will understand what God is doing. I want you to know the God of the Bible. In verse 3, and thou shalt put them into one basket and bring them in the basket with the bullock and two rams. And Aaron's and his sons thou shalt bring into the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and shall wash them with water. Now, this is signifying more than one thing, but the thing that we need to get out of this, he was washing them with water or cleansing them. You got to understand, many times we see things in an outward mode, thou shalt wash them with water, but many times God wants us, and he's depicting something that he wants to happen in our heart. He wants our heart to be cleaned up or sanctified, washing with water. They saw this when they were consecrating the priest, but yet when they see God doing and doing things in the methods and the ways that he's doing, we have to also think inwardly. What is God doing to the heart? So here God he said these words, and shall wash them with water, sanctify them, wash them with water. You got to understand, we can talk a lot about this and what it typifies, the regeneration, the daily cleansing. We can talk about all of that kind of stuff. But you got to understand, God wants us to be clean. He wants us to be clean on the outside, yes, but he wants us to be clean more so on the inside. Our hearts and our spirits should be clean, especially those that are going to minister in the house of the Lord. And I said this on the other day, and I'll say it again: if you name the name of a minister, a Bible teacher, all of these type of things, you should consecrate yourself, clean yourself up, and live a life and have a pure heart in doing so. God wants you clean. Why? Because you're representing him, and you want the people to be like God or to be like him. So in order for them to be like him, they have to clean up. And God wants us to clean our hearts and clean all of the folly out of our heart, all the things that are not like him. Yes, I'm talking to the priests, the preachers, or whatever you want to call yourself. Cleanse yourself. If you're going to be over God's people, if you're going to have a position over God's people, there's a way that you should walk, and you should walk humbly before God and with a clean heart and a clear conscience. And here, God is instructing them to wash Aaron and his sons with water now. Verse 5, and thou shalt take the garments and put upon Aaron the coat and the robe of the ephod and the ephod and the breastplates, and gird them with beautifully woven girdles of the ephod. Woven girdle of the ephod. Now take into consideration, first clean yourself up, clean your body up. It's a bad thing to put all types of beautiful garments on top of a dirty body. First thing he did is had them clean their body, and then put the garments that was made for them. Well, you got to understand, God wants us to clean our heart up, and then he may dress you up with a few positions, a few titles, whatever the case may be. But first, you need to clean yourself up. Why? That because you're representing God, and you're standing between God and the people. So clean yourself up, number one, and then God can put the garments that he has made for you. Verse 5 again, and thou shalt take the garments and put upon Aaron the coat and the robes of the ephod and the breastplates, and gird him with the beautifully woven girdle of the ephod. Shall we continue reading? And thou shalt put the mitre upon his head, and put the holy crown upon the mitre. Then shalt thou take the anointing oil and pour it upon his head and anoint him. Well, take that anointing oil and pour it upon his head and anoint him. I remember just like it was yesterday when I was ordained into the gospel ministry. Bishop W.S. Wilson ordained me. My pastor was his assistant, administrative assistant, Bishop Duffy. But Bishop Warren S. Wilson ordained my brother and I, my brother Robert and I, on the same day. I remember him pouring the oil on the top of my head and praying for me that God would use me and consecrate me to do a work for him. Well, this is what was happening. As we read 6-7 again, then shalt thou take the anointing oil and pour it upon his head and anoint him, and thou shalt bring his sons and put coats upon them, not just Aaron, but bring his sons also, and thou shalt gird them with girdles, Aaron and his sons, and put the turbans on them, and the priest's office shall be theirs for a perpetual statute. statute, the priest office. Can you understand? God is establishing something through Aaron and his family. The priest office shall be theirs for a perpetual statute. Anything perpetual is going on. It repeats, it repeats, it repeats. It's perpetual. The office of the priest office shall be theirs for a perpetual statute. A perpetual, keep that man by that word in your mind, and thou shalt consecrate Aaron and his sons. You got to understand, this office, the office of priest, was given to Aaron and his sons. You got to understand, as we get older, we're going to die. The older ones, we're going to leave this world. Well, I do know sometimes younger ones leave first, but you got to understand the order of things according to our age. We have it in our mind that we're going to leave this world one of these days. Well, you got to understand, God established some things so that even when we're gone, that legacy will carry on. And this was the case. He consecrated Aaron and his son. So this priest's office would be in that family perpetually. Well, let's read on in verse 10. And thou shalt cause a bullock to be brought before the tabernacle of the congregation. And Aaron and his son shall put their hands upon the head of the bullock. And thou shalt kill the bullock before the Lord by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And thou shalt take of the blood of the bullock and put it upon the horns of the altar with thy finger, and pour all the blood inside beside the bottom of the altar. I do know we're going to talk about blood as we continue reading in the Old Testament, and also when we refresh, when we get to the New Testament again, it's important. And a lot of times we don't know exactly what's going on, but you got to understand, God is so far above us in the heavenlies, and we're here on the earth. We see what's going on in the earth or in this realm, but you got to understand, God sees and knows in both realms. He knows the heavenlies, and he knows here down on this earth, and he knows how to bridge the gap between the two. He knows what the common denominator is to deal between the earthlies and the heavenlies. And as we study scripture, we're going to find that that's going to be blood, that common denominator that could appease heaven and also do for conditioning in the earthlies. I hope you understand what I'm saying. I'll read verse 12 again and continue. And thou shalt take of the blood of the bullocks and put it upon the horns of the altar with thy finger, and pour all the blood beside the bottom of the altar. And thou shalt take all the fat that covereth the inwards, and the fat that is above the liver, and two kidneys, and the fat that is upon them, and burn them upon the altar. But the flesh of the bullock and his skin, his dung, shall thou burn with fire outside the camp. It is a sin offering. Can you get the picture? Certain parts burn in the camp, other parts burn outside the camp, because that is a sin offering. God knows what he's doing. Who am I to question him and try to figure out all the logic of what God is doing? But I do know he's God, and if he tells you to do it, just do it. Obey him. Everything's going to be all right. In verse 15, and thou shalt take one ram, and Aaron and his son shall put their hands upon the head of the ram, and thou shalt slay the ram, and thou shalt take his blood and sprinkle it around about upon the altar. The blood of this ram, sprinkle it around about upon the altar. He's giving instructions now. He's consecrating these men in the priest office, and also not only consecrating the men, but even the altar around where they would be working. In verse 17, and thou shalt cut the ram in pieces, and wash the inwards of him and his legs, and put them into his pieces, and unto his head, and thou shalt burn the whole ram upon the altar. It is a burnt offering unto the Lord. It is a sweet savor, an offering made by fire unto the Lord. Well, this is the smell of it. You got to understand, God must love it. He must like that smell. You got to get that now. And thou shalt burn, I'm reading 18 again, and thou shalt burn the whole ram upon the altar. It is a burnt offering unto the Lord. It is a sweet savor, an offering made by fire unto the Lord, an offering unto the Lord. Let's read in verse 19. And thou shalt take the other ram, and Aaron and his son shall put their hand upon the head of the ram. And thou shalt kill the ram, and take of his blood, and put upon the tip of the right ear of Aaron, and upon the tip of the right ear of his sons, and upon the thumb of their right hand, and upon the great toe of their right foot, and sprinkle the blood upon the altar around about. Why is God doing it? I'll be honest, I don't know. But if God said do it, that's what you're supposed to do. Let's read verse 21. And thou shalt take the blood that is upon the altar and of the anointing oil, and sprinkle it upon Aaron and upon his garments and upon his sons and upon the garments of his sons with him. And he shall be hallowed. He shall be hallowed. Maybe I should talk about that word hallowed. Maybe I'll take time to talk about it on the next time. Hallowed. We even mentioned that word in the Lord's Prayer. Hallowed be thy name. Holy be thy name. Honored be thy name. We are offering up something that's so great and so powerful. Hallowed. Honored be thy name. I shouldn't have even went there, but I'm going to dig into it further in our next time. On the next time, I'll read that again. And thou shalt take the blood that is upon the altar and of the anointing oil and sprinkle it upon Aaron and upon his garments and upon his sons and upon the garments of his sons with him. And he shall be hallowed. And his garments, and his sons, and his sons' garments with him. Well, let's read another few verses. Also, thou shalt take of the ram the fat of the rump, and the fat that covered the inwards, and the fat above the liver, and the two kidneys, and the fat that is upon them, and the right shoulder, for it is a ram of consecration. Take these parts, a ram of consecration. Verse 23, and one loaf of bread, and one cake of oil bread, and one wafer out of the basket of the unleavened bread that is before the Lord. And thou shalt put all in the hands of Aaron and in the hands of his sons, and shall wave them for a wave offering before the Lord. A wave offering before the Lord. Well, maybe we'll discuss this further. Verse 25, and thou shalt receive them from their hands, and burn them upon the altar for a burnt offering, for a sweet savor before the Lord. It is an offering made by fire unto the Lord. It's an offering unto the Lord. Well, this is what we do. We offer what we have unto the Lord. God is instructing them, give this unto the Lord. It's not for carnal purposes, but give it unto the Lord. You got to understand, we just need to bless the Lord sometime. He blesses us all the time, but sometimes we just need to bless him with things that he enjoys. Bless him. And he loved that smell. No, I'm not telling you to start sacrificing animals or anything of that nature. But I do know one that he loved that sacrificed his own life for us. My Lord and my Savior Jesus Christ sacrificed his life for us. You got to understand, God is pleased. God is pleased when we do what he tells us to do. God is pleased, and he loves when we honor him the way he tells us to do so. And he told his son to do what he did. Jesus shed his blood for us. Now we don't have to depend upon the blood of bulls and the blood of rams and the blood of animals for our sacrifice. Not anymore. Why? Because Jesus shed his blood for you and for me. Jesus paid the price once and for all. So we don't have to offer every year. We're going to talk about this as we unfold the Old Testament. You got to understand, we are a kingdom of priests. Not just one priest or one family that's priest, but we can all go directly to God. We can all stand in the presence of God. Why? Because we are a kingdom of priests. No, I didn't call you a king, but you are in a kingdom of priests. That we can stand before God, we can entreat the Lord, we can talk to him, he will talk to us. Why? Because he's God, and he's made it that way for us. He's paid the price through his son, our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Well, my friends, I want you to know that I love you. I love you with the love of the Lord. If you would like to contact me for any reason, you can write me at the Word with Chester Ministries, Post Office Box 200483, San Antonio, Texas, 78220. You can also reach me at my website, www.poemsbychester.com. Remember our CD that's there? Also, go to iTunes. We have a new single that's been released, and you will be blessed by it. I encourage you to listen to it and purchase it, and God will bless you, and you will be a blessing to this ministry. The new single that I have available for you is titled, A Friend for Life. Remember, I love you, my friends. I love you with the love of the Lord. God bless you.